الحمد لله لمن لا اله قبل له والصلاه والسلام على النبي لمن لا نبي بعد له اما بعد فاعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم وانك لعلى خلق عظيم صدق الله العظيم ان الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي يا ايها الذين امنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما اللهم صل على سيدنا ومولانا محمد وعلى ال سيدنا ومولانا محمد المبارك وسلم وصلي عليه my brothers and sisters assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh I want to apologize for arriving a little bit late traditionally actually I always make it a rule to arrive half an hour or an hour before the event unfortunately today for me I was booked in for yesterday because yesterday I don't have such late teaching hours but today being a Wednesday it was I finished awfully late and so I set out a bit later than I should have InshaAllah, may Allah Ta'ala forgive us for our shortcomings. We are talking about the Blessed Messenger Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam and his beauty. And really the beauty of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam is captured in a couplet where Imam Busiri Rahimahullah Ta'ala wrote, كَأَنَّهُ وَهُوَ فَرْضٌ مِّن جَلَالَتِهِ في عسكر حين تلقاه وفي حشر he said such is his splendor that even alone in his glory superb courtiers and guards seem to stand around him i.e. his beauty in his presence and in his existence is so great that everybody that surrounds him appears to be beautiful as a result of him alayhi salatu wasalam and this indeed was the case right but the beauty of the prophet alayhi salatu wasalam was it starts really from I mean the beauty of the prophet alayhi salatu wasalam was visibly there on his blessed face and so when we speak of the prophet and the messenger alayhi salatu wasalam we speak of a messenger who was most perfect in his appearance he who had the most perfect of faces that was neither prolonged or oval in any way and nor was it too circular though it was as if it was slightly more circular than oval He had the most beautiful thick brows above his eyes and this is not to say that they were overgrown in any way and not to say that they were bushy but they were very prominent and he had a slight gap between his brows just above his nose and he had a vein which started off from the top of the brow and arced off towards the right of his blessed forehead sallallahu alaihi wasallam and he had a color of skin which was neither white not such that you could call him pale in any way nor was he brown that anybody would look upon him and call him dark and the sahaba always described him and said he was the fairest of all people with a slight redness in his skin and beautifully one of the sahabi described the prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam as being somebody who he said if you want to know would you know what the color of the messenger was it was like the grain of a wheat have you ever seen the grain of a wheat that it is creamy in color and it has bits of red within it this is how the messenger alayhi salatu wasalam was in terms of his appearance and he alayhi salatu wasalam had an incredible nur and presence that emanated from both his body and from his face alayhi salatu wasalam and so if you look at all of the literal portraits that we have of the prophet sallallahu alayhi wasalam that every single one of them has come from a sahabi who was a child in the time of the prophet sallallahu alayhi wasalam because if they were adults By Allah, if they were adults, they did not lift up their eyes and look him directly in his face or in his eyes. And Sayyidina Amr ibn al-As says, if somebody asked me to describe the Messenger, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, I couldn't, because I never lifted my eyes long enough towards him to see exactly what he looked like. He was too much. One Sahabi narrated, and this is a beautiful narration, he said, كَأَنَّ الشَّمْسَ تَجْرِي فِي وَجْهِهِ. He said, when you look up, do any of you look up and stare at the sun? This is explaining to us his incredible presence and beauty. He said, do you ever look up and stare at the sun? He said, you look up, you glance for a moment, but then you know my eyes will burn if I look too long. He said, this is how it was. كَأَنَّ الشَّمْسَ تَجْرِي فِي وَجْهِهِ. It's like the sun was glowing in his face. So anybody who was sensible would not stare at him, alayhi salatu wasalam. It was actually always the kids. And the kids know no better, you see. They have the audacity to stare at the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasalam, and they count the number of white hairs he had on this side of his beard and the number of white hair that he had on this side of his beard. And he, alayhi salatu wasalam, and he had an incredible presence. Sayyidina Abu Mas'ud al-Badri says that once I was hitting a slave of mine, and whilst I was beating him, somebody shouted to me from a distance and said, I'lam Abu Mas'ud, be warned, be aware, Abu Mas'ud. He said, I was so angry and I was so furious, la altafito, I didn't even turn. I didn't even turn to see who it was behind me, calling me, until the footsteps of the one came much, much closer to me. And when I turned, فَإِذَا هُوَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمُ. And when I turned, I found that it was the Messenger of Allah, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And the moment I saw him, he said, the staff that I had in my hand, it fell. It fell immediately from my hand. And the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam said, oh Abu Mas'ud, there is a Lord and Master over you, just as you are a master over this slave.
Subhanallah.
Right? And so he said, he taught me a lesson. And this is the beauty of the way that he would not reprimand people, but he would teach them a lesson. Consider this, that there is a Lord over you, just as you are a Lord over this slave, a master over this slave today. There is a master. And so if you deal with him kindly, your Lord will deal with you kindly. He said, I swear by Allah, I will never ever hit another slave again. And he said, I never did. He, alayhi salatu wasalam, had the most perfect of noses. And Sayyidina Ali karamallahu wajha said he had a nose that was prominent. And this is not to mean that his nose was big, such that it had a shine that came off of it. But whenever a person looked at his blessed nose, alayhi salatu wasalam, they found that it was perfectly proportioned in relation to the rest of his face, alayhi salatu wasalam. He had the darkest of brown eyes, so much so that the Sahaba said that his eyes were black. And he had slight redness coming off of the black eyeball, coming away on the whites of his eyes. And he would enhance the beauty and the appearance of his eyes using kohl. He would use what we call surma today, he would use that, and it would further enhance the appearance of his blessed eyes, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And he would recommend this. He would say you should use kuhl because it enhances the sight and it nourishes the eyelashes. And he, alayhi salatu wasalam, had the most perfect body in terms of height. He was not a man who was tall, such that if you look towards him, anyone may call him lanky or call him a giant. He wasn't like that. And at the same time, he wasn't a short man, such that if somebody was speaking to him, that they would look down upon him when they spoke. And we only read in hadith that whenever he stood amongst the people, he always stood out as the most prominent of all men.
Subhanallah.
Right? And he didn't. You know, he had such a beautiful quality within himself that if he were, I mean, he had the most perfect stateliness, right? And he was the best of monarchs. He was the best of kings, such that if he was sat opposite a king, and often Sayyidina Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu ta'ala, who would propose to the Messenger of Allah, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and say, "O Messenger of God, should we not buy you the best of robes? Should we not buy you the best of clothes? So that when you sit opposite a king, you don't look like the one who is sat in the lesser of the clothing?" And he said, "No, I don't need this." And this is the truth. He never ever needed this. So when he, alayhi salatu wasalam, sat opposite the kings, and he sat opposite the leaders, his green imama tied around his head was a more glorious crown than the crown that sat upon the kings. This is what Allah Almighty has given. And he, alayhi salatu wasalam, had the most perfectly defined features of his body. His shoulders were broad. And there was a beauty to having broad shoulders. He was a very strong man. And this is not to say that he would be like a muscle man. He wasn't like this. Nothing like this. But his features were very well defined. So his shoulders was defined. His chest was defined. And he was incredibly strong. And Allah Almighty granted him the most perfect strength. Right, the most perfect strength. And he, alayhi salatu wasalam, would sometimes, when he would be seen lifting things, and he would lift the stones to build the masjids, and the Sahaba would say, "But Ya Rasulullah, you don't lift the stone. Let us lift the stones for you." And he would say, "No, don't. Let me, I'll carry the stones." And when they would insist and say, no, let us lift the stones," he would turn to them and say, "Is it that you think that I am weaker than any man amongst you? Or is it that you think that I am any less in need of the reward from my Lord Allah?" And if on either count you think that, then you are wrong. Right? So let me carry what I carry. And he would carry his own burdens. In fact, he had such a perfect strength. It's demonstrated when they were in the battle of Khandaq, in the battle of the trenches. The Muslims went through some very, very hard times. An attack of the Meccans was imminent. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam had commanded that we are going to dig the trenches. It's a new way of defending this oasis of Medina. This is how we are going to do it. They start to dig the trenches, and this is in the heat of the day, and then they dig through for days on end, and there is absolutely no respite from this work. And he is alongside all of his companions every single day with the spade, with the shovel, just digging alongside everyone else. And so this is where that, and this is a very, very famous tradition where one Sahabi comes to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam after 3 days of having had nothing to eat and constant digging. He approached the Messenger of God sallallahu alaihi wasallam and said, "O Messenger, do you know how hungry I am today? Can I tell you how hungry I am? I'm so hungry today, so hungry, that I cannot bear the pain. It is now so much for me that this is what I'm led to." And he lifts up his shirt, revealing a stone tied to his stomach. And he says, "Look, I've got a stone tied to my stomach to try to kill off the hunger. I can't bear this anymore." And the Blessed Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam picks up his shirt and he reveals two stones.
Subhanallah.
He says, "You're that hungry, right? And this is how hungry I am. Right? We're all in this together." And this is 3 days of having had nothing to eat. The men are digging. And so three or four Sahabi come across a boulder, and it's perched perilously on top of the trench that they're building. And they struggle to move it, they struggle to break it. They approach the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and they say, "O Messenger, there's a boulder by the trench, and we don't know what to do. We can't move it, we've tried, we can't break it, we've tried, and we can't leave it there, because if we dig underneath it, it's a hazard, it's going to become problematic for us. And so what do we do about this?" And so they've already tried, and they've used their axes and done what they need to. And the Messenger of God, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, said, "You take me to it." And he was carrying his spade, the same spade that he had been digging with. And so he said, "Take me to this boulder." And he walked towards the boulder, and he lifted it one hand. He lifts his spade, And he brings it down really hard on this boulder. On the first occasion, nothing happens. So he picks up his hand again, and he brings it down second time. Nothing happens. On the third time, he lifts it up, and he hits it real hard. On the third time of asking, the entire boulder comes to pieces, and it turns into dust. This is the strength, the perfect strength of the Messenger, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This is the Messenger who has not eaten for 3 days and has stones tied to his stomach. Had he not had those stones tied to his stomach, that boulder did not stand a chance even after the first strike. It never stood a chance. This is the perfect strength that Allah Almighty had endowed the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. It was demonstrated elsewhere. It was demonstrated with Rukana, who was a wrestler. And he came to the Messenger of God sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and said, "Will you wrestle me?" And he knew, nobody's ever defeated me in this area. Nobody's ever going to overcome me. And I will go to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and I will say to him, "Come and wrestle me." Then one of two things will happen. Either he is too noble and he won't come out, in which case I will humiliate him. Or he will come out and I will beat him, in which case I will humiliate him. So either way, I will defeat him. And there's no way that anything could go wrong. So when he approached the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, "Will you come out then and wrestle me, if you really are a Messenger of God?" And he said, "If I came out and wrestled you and overcame you, would you accept that there is none worthy of worship except Allah and that Muhammad is the Messenger?" He didn't agree to it. And he didn't. He said, "Well, we'll see. You come out, we'll see what happens." And so then they come out, and he comes and he charges towards the Messenger, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And he, again, even in this riwayat, it says that he uses his right hand, not even his left. So he doesn't need to use his left, you see. With perfect strength, you can rely on one hand, it's enough. And so he charges at him, and when he charges, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam grabs Rukana from his left side. And with a single hand, he pulls him straight down to the ground. And Rukana, he's shocked at what's just happened. This doesn't happen to him, right? And so the Prophet alayhi wa sallam lets go of him, and he gets up again. And the moment he gets up, he charges at the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam again. Again, in one hand, he grabs him from the left side and he puts him straight back to the ground again. Let's go. Third occasion, he gets up again, charges at the Prophet alayhi wa sallam. He just grabs him with one hand and pins him to the ground. And when on the third time, Rukana gets up, he gets up and he marches off because he cannot bear the shame of being dropped 3 times like this with one hand. And as he marches off, he didn't accept Islam then, he accepted Islam later. He said, "At that point, as I walked off, I said, what sort of sorcery is this? He grabs me by the left side and my right side goes limp." Right? So surely, if with my right hand, I should be able to kick him, punch him, do something with my right. He grabs me on the left, but my right side goes. What sort of sorcery is this? Later he says, "I reflected on this and I thought, if this isn't the Messenger of God, who else will it be?" He, alayhi salatu wasalam, had the most perfect of hearts. And Allah Almighty, it says in hadith that when Allah Almighty created the hearts of all of mankind, of all of the hearts, He picked the one heart and He said, "This one I will keep with me." And he said that one is the heart that he was going to send down with his message right at the end or after the line of all of his prophets. And then he said after that, he alayhi salatu wasalam said after that Allah Almighty then went back and looked at all of the other hearts. And the best of the hearts that he found of them, he made my companions. And so the best of the hearts was the heart of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And then the best of the hearts after that were given to the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He alayhi salatu wasalam, in his in his maqam, and the heart is incredibly important. It is incredibly important. Why? Because the heart is the thing which carries faith. And for us, this is it's a big deal. But if you think about the heart of the Prophet ﷺ, it wasn't just going to carry faith. It was going to carry the verses of the Quran. Yeah, وَلَوْ أَنزَلْنَا هَذَا الْقُرْآنَ عَلَى جَبَلٍ لَرَأَيْتَهُ خَاشِئًا مُتَصَدِّعًا مِنْ خَشْيَةِ اللَّهِ. This heart had to be strong enough to cope with the revelation of the Quran. Although, had this same Quran been revealed to a mountain, you would have seen that sway, right? In the incredible pressure that a heart comes under. So this is what the heart was purified so much for. أَلَمْ نَشْرَحْ لَكَ صَدْرَكَ. Did we not expand for you your heart? Did we not develop it? Did we not get it to a place that it was ready? And that what it did, it built absolute certainty into the Prophet ﷺ. There was never a point where the Prophet ﷺ, he suffered anxieties, he suffered worries about his family, he suffered concerns about his ummah, people who were going to come after him. But he never ever suffered anxieties of his religion. He was so certain in that. And it was so perfect. His belief was so perfect in what he had brought to the people. And one example of this is that when a Bedouin approaches the Prophet and he comes to him swearing and shouting and screaming and humiliating, and he spares him absolutely nothing of the insults that he can muster. And the Prophet ﷺ with his companions stand up, and they're really, really angry at this man, and they want to punish him right there and then. And the Prophet ﷺ says, no, this isn't our way. Right? We don't punish him, just let him say his piece. You all sit down. Right? This was important. وَلَوْ كُنْتَ فَزَّنَ غَلِيزَ الْقَلْبِ لَنْ فَدُّوا مِنْ حَوْلِكَ. Right? If you were hard or difficult in your mannerisms, they would have dispersed from you. فَعْفُ عَنْهُمْ وَاسْتَغْفِرْ لَهُمْ وَشَاوِرْهُمْ فِي الْأَمْرِ. As Allah Almighty said, I didn't make you like this. I sent you down with a beautiful heart. So your job, when all of the Sahaba get up and say we want to attack the Bedouin who insults our messenger, your job isn't to join in with them, but to say to them, you sit down, let me deal with it. Right? So he sat everybody down and said, let the man say what he wants to say. So when he had finished, he said to the Bedouin, why do you insult me when you don't know me? Why do you not try to speak to me? Once you have spoken to me and recognized me, then you take your decision, right? And maybe I could offer you something of value. I am the messenger of Allah. And when he said this, sallallahu alayhi wasallam, when he said this, the Bedouin said, but this is the problem, the messenger of Allah. You're not the messenger of Allah. You're not. That's the problem, right? You have caused our tribes to become separated. You have caused strife amongst the people. You're not the messenger of Allah. And if you are, as he's saying this, he storms off and he brings a lizard. And he says, right, okay then, if you really are the messenger of Allah, then make this believe that you're the messenger of Allah. So he holds the lizard up to the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. And he says, but make this believe. And if the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam had the slightest of doubt or uncertainty, it perhaps would have become evident. But there was absolutely no doubt. There is absolutely no uncertainty about what he has brought. So he turns to the lizard and he says, Man ana? Who am I? And the lizard says, Anta Muhammadun Rasulullah. The lizard speaks and says, you are Muhammad, the messenger of God. This is why in Qasidatul Salam we read, Salamun ala man qala liddabi man ana. Faqala Rasulullah, Anta Muhammadun. May the peace descend upon the one who says to a lizard, who am I? And the lizard says to Rasulullah, you must be Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But it's absolute certainty of the heart. There wasn't a moment where he suffered this doubt that if I say something, will the lizard respond to me? And he alayhi salatu wasalam, and he had that in absolute perfection. It was a beauty which then rubbed off onto his Sahaba, and his Sahaba were absolutely certain. And you know, when that Bedouin walked off, he said, I came here hating nobody more in this world than this man, and as I walk off, I can tell you, I love nobody more than this man. And this is what he did to the people. He brought them to the path through hikmah, and he, alayhi salatu wasalam, had the most perfect hikmah. Right, the most perfect wisdom. He offered words that were words that just could not have been for his time. Right, and if you think about, this is years on now, and today we talk about wars and we talk about winning and losing wars, and today we know it's a big thing. If you want to win a battle or a war, it is all about the interception of communication. Right? When two people are communicating, it's perhaps the man who sits in Bletchley in Milton Keynes who's going to win your war for you. Right? Because he's going to work out what messages are coming and going. And this is something that we think that is discovered now, but 1400 years ago, Sayyidina Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam turned to Sayyidina Zayd ibn Thabit and said, you are incredibly intelligent. Why do you not learn the language of the Jewish scripture? Right, learn their language. And he said, but Ya Rasulullah, you always forbid us of this. You said that the message I bring you is clearer than clear, is whiter than white. Why would I? He said, no, learn it. Because it'll save you from the mischief. Because when they come to battle, when they come to fight with you, you will all communicate with one another and they will all understand, but they will communicate and you'll have no idea. Right, so learn the language. It's wisdom which was far, far ahead of its own time. He, alayhi salatu wasalam, delivered wisdom that we perhaps couldn't understand. And he delivers just very simple words, and the best of his words were never, he, alayhi salatu wasalam, never used complicated words. He always used language which was appropriate. And he taught everybody. He said, always look at the people that you're speaking to and then speak accordingly. He said, speak at their level. كَلِّمُ النَّاسَ عَلَىٰ حَسْبِ عُقُولِهِمْ. Speak at their level of understanding so that you have a message to deliver. This message has to be delivered. And so, you know, his wisdom, and I'll tell you, you could pick up any one of the traditions of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and years later, it'll really dawn on you just how profound a statement that was. In a couple of narrations, I'm going to share with you very, very simple narrations that appear very simplistically, very simplistic outwardly when you first look at them. The Prophet ﷺ in one hadith, he said, give charity, it increases your life. Right? It seems very simplistic. He ﷺ said, enjoy good relations with your family, it increases your life. And we took these traditions, and years ago, our commentators on hadith have always been writing, oh, the saying of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam about give charity and increasing your life, what it is, it increases the quality of your life. And so you live a happier lifestyle, you live a better lifestyle, and this is what the objective of the hadith is. But only 2 years ago, 3 years ago, one of the broadsheet newspapers ran an article on centurions, people who had reached the age of 100, and they asked them, they said, what is your secret? How did you get to 100? And they tried to find the pattern or the rule of why this particular group of people reached the age of 100 and others don't. And so they tried to pick out patterns, and so they said it's a possibility that they were non-smokers. That's not true. Some of them were smokers. So then they tried to pick out the chance that maybe they were all very, very fit throughout their lives. Some of them said we didn't exercise, some of them said we didn't. They then said maybe it's to do with the food groups that they were eating, but there was too broad a range of food groups for them. So at the end of this study, they concluded that the one thing that every single one of them had in common was that they had extremely good relations with their family members. Right? And so later, the scientists went back and they tried to work this out. Why? What relation is there between good family ties and this becoming a centurion? Well, they put it down to, they said that the brain produces chemicals, and one of the chemicals that it produces is serotonin. And serotonin is the happy chemical, right? The happy chemical is the chemical that gives you the electric feeling through your body when you see something good. When you're amazed and shocked at something, your body shivers and you experience that moment, right? That's a release of serotonin. And they said if somebody's body produces reasonable amounts of serotonin, it increases and extends the physical life of a person. Right? And then you go back and you read this hadith and you say, SubhanAllah, he wasn't talking about your quality of life. He wasn't. He was actually talking about your physical life being extended when you show kindness towards your family. Right? Because his knowledge and wisdom was the most perfect of knowledge and the most perfect of wisdom. And then the scientists say now that you should always engage in good acts, because good acts help three people. One, the person who is doing it, he feels a sense of joy and pleasure. It'll increase his life. The person to whom it is being done, he experiences joy and pleasure. And the one who witnesses this good act, he feels and experiences a joy and pleasure. So this many people are being affected by this. Just from the simple words of the Prophet ﷺ, give sadaqah and increase your lives. And make enjoying good relations with your family and increase your lives. Right? This is the most perfect of wisdom. And he, alayhi salatu wasalam, when he would speak to the people, he never addressed the people for too long. Right? So we shouldn't address the people, and I'll try not to address you for too long, he says, after speaking for half an hour. Okay, I don't want to be saying I'm going to keep you and finish quickly and then be talking for an hour. Right, so he, alayhi salatu wasalam, never spoke for too long. All the Sahaba, Sayyidina Abdullah ibn Umar radiallahu ta'ala, who was an incredible orator. And there were very few people who could match his ability of speaking. And the people would say to Sayyidina Abdullah ibn Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhumah, would you not deliver lectures every single day? And he refused them. He said, no, I won't deliver lectures to you every day. And they said, why will you not deliver? He said, because the messenger wouldn't deliver lectures to us every day. And he said, why would the messenger not? He said, because the messenger was worried that we might become bored of what he was saying. Right? So he never ever spoke so long that anybody ever got bored of him. And when he spoke, he was never deliberately poetic, right? He didn't use poetry, right? Because if you go into poetry, you're more concerned about getting the right rhyme to end at the end of your couplets. You're too concerned with creating the perfect prose. You're too concerned with getting the right number of syllables in words. And all the time, you may detract from the actual message that you are delivering. His words were always natural and fitting. Sometimes his words rhymed only where one word naturally flowed into the next, and he did it effortlessly. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He never made conscious efforts of this. And whenever he would speak, he would do so in the most perfect of ways, and he would use his hands. And where he would want to make a point of something, he would repeat a statement three times. And he would strike the thumb of his left hand into the palm of his right when making a point of something. This is the beautiful mannerisms that he adopted when conversing or talking addressing a people. Whenever he, alayhi salatu wasalam, was asked a question, he always afforded the person who is asking his absolute attention, regardless of who it was, regardless of who it may be. So he never just turned his blessed head to listen to what the person is saying, but he turned his blessed body towards them to say that I am listening to you. And he listened, even if he were delivering a sermon, and a Bedouin would walk in and would ask a question, and they would ask the most unusual of questions, and he would tolerate them, and he would say, he would either answer the question, or he would say to them, just sit there for one moment, and when I finish, I will address you and I will answer your question. And then he would get to the end of his sermon and say, where is the one who asked about? And then he would answer their question. He, alayhi salatu wasalam, taught this perfect wisdom to his companions. So when he sent his companions away to other people to invite them towards the deen, he always knew who he is sending his people to. He looked at them and he did things that were remarkable. He used to look at the character of the person that he was sending a message to. So if he felt that that person is intelligent enough for us to provide him good evidences that they will believe, he sent them evidences so that people would believe. And if it were a person that he thought just needs to be told really in a very straightforward manner, that this is a worship of one God and that I am his messenger, he sent just simply that message. So some places he sent his men saying, accept that there is none worthy of worship except Allah Almighty and that I am his messenger. So sometimes the message was one case where he sent his Sahaba off to one Zoroastrian fire worshipper, a king, a leader, and he said, when you go to him, be very thoughtful. Don't insult him, he's an intelligent man. And don't be abusive towards him in any way, don't humiliate him in any way, because he has a high social standing. Be careful of that. And don't patronize him, right? Because people don't like to be patronized. And so when the Sahaba arrived there, they greeted him in the best of ways. And they said, do you know that the Messenger of God says about you that you are amongst the most intelligent of men? And he says, yeah, absolutely, he's right. I am the most intelligent of men. And he said that you have the most excellent understanding. He said, you're right. He's absolutely right. The message you brought, yeah, I have the most excellent of understanding. And they said to him, and we know that you worship the fire. He said, I do worship the fire. They said, we know that the fire is beneficial. Right? The fire is the thing that provides us light through the darkness. It's the fire that gives us heat when it's cold. It's the fire on which we cook our foods and heat our water. But surely you are an intelligent man, and you must have thought that all of the benefits of the fire appear to be for the one who is alive. How does the fire benefit the man who is dead? Right? And that's all they said. And they just left him with that for a while. So a couple of days later, they came back to him and said, did you consider what we said? Did you consider that the fire has no benefit after you have passed away? He said, I've considered your words, and I think there may be some truth in that, because I cannot work out what benefit the fire can give to a man after he has passed away. And so then they said to him, and the Messenger of God says, would you not just stop worshipping the fire and instead worship the one who created the fire?
SubhanAllah! Right?
And he, you know, at this point he didn't accept Islam. He sent them away with gifts. He later accepted Islam. Right? And he did. It was incredible wisdom and beauty. It's the beauty that was carried from the Prophet ﷺ to the Sahaba. It was the beauty that was then distributed by the Sahaba onwards to all others. In a similar case, some Sahaba was sent off to Mokotis, a Christian king in Alexandria. And this Christian king was known for being quite an open-hearted man, but he had something of a way that he would always insult or humiliate people on their way out. So he was a king, so he did what people do. So just to always stamp his power and authority, as somebody was leaving, he would always ridicule them in some way. So these Muslims arrived in his governance into his area, and so he looked after them for a couple of days. And so whilst they were there, one day he invited all of his Christian ministers, and he stood them there and he thought, all right, this is a fantastic moment. Let's just humiliate them just for a couple of moments, then they can all be on the way. And so he said to them, so you say that the man you come from is a messenger of God? And they say, yes, we come from a messenger of God. So you say that he is a man who calls to righteousness? And they say, yes, he is a man who calls to righteousness. So you say that he is a man whose prayers are answered? We say, yes, he is a man whose prayers are answered. So do you not also say that he's a man who's been driven out of his own country by his own people? They said, yes, he's been driven out of his own area by his own people. He said, but would he then have not just lifted his hands and prayed and said, oh God, protect me amongst my people? Right. It's a good question. So they turned to him and said, you believe in the Prophet Isa alayhi salatu wasalam? He said, yes, I do. You believe that he was the most prominent of all the prophets? He said, yes, I do. You believe that he was the most righteous of people? Yes, I believe he was. You believe that his prayers were answered by God? Yes, I believe his prayers were answered. So why then, when he was lifted by his people and they took him to crucify him, did he not lift his hands and say, oh Allah, protect me from these people? And Mokokis laughed and he said, you are an intelligent group of men having come from an intelligent man. Right? This is the way that they used to address what was before them. This is the way that the Sahaba were taught by the Prophet ﷺ, that you always act with a great deal of wisdom. You always act according to what the situation requires of you. And if you've got people who are noble in front of you, don't just go out there and insult and abuse and chant things that will offend. Don't. This is not our method. Our method is that we talk within reason. We are very reasonable people. We have a message which is a truth within itself. Right? The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, after the age of 40, declared his prophethood. But 40 years prior to that, he had established himself as being the most trustworthy. And sometimes our scholars reflect on this. They say after the age of 40, he read the Quran out to the people. Before the age of 40, he had demonstrated the Quran to the people. Right? So even everything that he did, it just put him perfectly in place. But I'll tell you one thing, that the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam used all of his beauty, all of his perfection, all of his energy for just one thing, and that is the propagation of his religion. And so if anybody tried to entice him or take him away from that message, and Imam Busiri rahimahullah ta'ala writes a beautiful couplet. He says that sometimes even the mountains turn to gold to try to attract and distract the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But how could a thing attract him when it had only been created because of him? Right? The mountains are attractive to you and me. Right? They weren't attractive to him. He said that if I were given a mountain of gold, I would not let 3 days pass except that I would distribute everything amongst the people. You know, his beauty was his generosity towards the people around him. You know, his incredible generosity. On one occasion, he prayed Salatul Asr, and this is narrated in Bukhari, it's narrated in Muslim, in other sahihs as well. He once prayed Asr, and he rushed off immediately after the prayer. And the Sahaba, they had never seen him rush off so quickly before. So when he alayhi salatu wasalam entered back into the masjid, they said, Ya Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasalam, is everything okay? He said, yes, everything is okay. But Ya Rasulullah, you rushed off. We were concerned or worried why you had rushed off. And he alayhi salatu wasalam said, I rushed off because I had a gold coin within my household. And I was standing here praying, and I thought to myself, how am I praying here whilst I still have a gold coin within my house? That should be distributed amongst the people. And I wasn't satisfied until I rushed off immediately after the prayer, and I have had that distributed amongst the people. Now I am back here again and satisfied. He said, pride is my poverty. Poverty is my pride. That's what he used to say. Poverty is what I am. I have chosen poverty over richness. I have chosen this poverty. And this poverty which he chose is the pride for us. And he is the best of all people in this dunya, and he is the best of them in the hereafter. And even the prophets and the messengers, he is the best of them. It was demonstrated when he led all of the Anbiya and Rasul in Al-Aqsa on the night of Isra. It was demonstrated by the verses of the Quran when Allah Almighty said to the prophets, when he says, I took a covenant or an agreement from the prophets, and the prophets are the best of all people. And Allah Almighty says, I said to the prophets, لَمَا أَتَيْتُكُمْ مِنْ كِتَابٍ وَحِكْمَةٍ, even whilst I have given you all of this kitab, I have given you a revelation, and I have given you this wisdom, ثُمَّ جَاءَكُمْ رَسُولٌ مُصَدِّقٌ لِمَا مَعَكُمْ لَتُؤْمِنُنَّ بِهِ وَلَتَنْصُرُنَّ. He said that after you having received your revelation, if a messenger came to you confirming all that which is with you, would you agree that you will all help him and believe in him? Right? And this is why when the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said to the Sahaba, because sometimes the Sahaba would come with scriptures of the Ahli Kitab and they would read it, and he would say to them, don't, because perhaps you will read something and believe in something which is actually not true, and perhaps you will disbelieve and reject something in it which is actually true. And so would you not then just believe in what I have brought to you, which is the most perfect, which is the most pure, which is the most white and the most beautiful? And then he said, he would say that if Sayyidina Musa alayhi salatu wasalam were born today, were alive today, he would have absolutely no choice but to follow the deen that I have brought. And he did not say this in boast. He did not say this in pride. He said this because it was a matter of fact. This is the maqam that Allah Almighty gave him in this dunya. And in the hereafter, Allah Almighty says, he discusses the hereafter, and the hereafter is just almost, it's just a maqam of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, which he, alayhi salatu wasalam, perfectly deserves. Allah Almighty said to him in the Quran, وَلَا الْآخِرَةُ خَيْرٌ لَكَ مِنَ الْأُولَى. He said the hereafter is going to be better, even better for you than this present world. And what of the hereafter did he say? Allah Almighty describes the hereafter. This is the scene that is being set for you. Allah Almighty says, فَكَيْفَ إِذَا جِئْنَا مِنْ كُلِّ أُمَّةٍ بِشَهِيدٍ وَجِئْنَا بِكَ عَلَى هَؤُلَاءِ شَهِيدًا. How glorious is that day going to be? How beautiful is that day going to be when we bring a witness out of every single nation, i.e. when their prophets come forward, when their messengers come forward as witnesses over each nation. And then we bring you, O Messenger, as a witness over all of those people. You will be the crowning glory on that day. So we ask Allah Almighty that he raises the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam to the Maqam Mahmood, to the promised station, and that he grants us his shafa'at. We read in the Sahih of Imam Bukhari in Kitab al-Adhan that the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam said, whosoever raised his hands after the Adhan and said, O Lord of this call and this perfect prayer, we beg of you that you will send the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to the Maqam Mahmood, shafa'at for him will become obligatory on the Day of Judgment. And so this is why we make this dua, Allahumma rabba hadhihi ad-da'wat at-tamma wa salat al-qa'imah ati sayyidina Muhammadan al-wasilata wa al-fadila wa ba'athhu maqaman mahmudan alladhi wa'adta. We always pray. And he doesn't need our prayers. Allah Almighty has promised this maqam. We need to be making this prayer. And the reason why we need to be making this prayer is so that on the Day of Judgment, when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam stands there, he has a good reason to vouch for you. So that he can say, these people are my forgetful people. These are the neglectful people. These are the ones who tried but failed. They did everything they could. But Ya Allah, how can I turn away from them today when they were the ones who constantly kept saying, Ya Allah, raise me to this maqam. Raise me to this maqam. And now you've brought me to this maqam. As you have given me something, I beg of you that you will give them something. أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله لي ولكم.